Hi guys, this is Vaish. So we are again starting a new series which we had announced last year, but because of certain issues we could not proceed with it. Okay, so RS Sharma also we were doing and we had stopped it last year, and I have resumed it. Okay, sometime back I have uploaded the RS Sharma Ancient History chapter number 19. Okay, so and I had asked 2-3 questions, so I expect students to equally participate and then give the answers in comment section also. Because the more you interact, the more we feel like making new videos for you. Okay, else if it's like just for 100 people or 120 people who is viewing, we don't think it is feasible, okay, to put this effort and record the lectures, because it's all anyway with you. You are going to read this for your exam, but we are just trying it to put it digital so that you can view this any number of times. Okay, because we all have this problem of feeling lazy when we read books. Okay, textbooks when we read, we can read one time or two times, but the third time if we want again something, we don't feel like again opening the textbook and searching for it. Okay, how much ever you highlight it or underline it. So that is where videos will help you, okay, because you can easily scroll and reach a particular point. So try to appreciate what is being done so that we also feel like doing more. Okay, so hope you understand that point. So with that, I'm going to start this Medieval India. Okay, Satish Chandra, you know, a much recommended textbook for Medieval India. Even though questions are decreasing every year in prelims, it is very, very important for history optional students. Okay, and in GS paper also, if you see the culture part of ancient and medieval history is very much asked repeatedly. Okay, any court poet or any literature, any books written, something like that, any dance form, something like that is always asked. Okay, repeatedly in GS1, one question, 10 marker it's coming. So you need to know. So when we tell medieval, kind of 14th 15th century we'll start from. Okay, that is how this text is designed. So we'll start with the advent of Mughals. Okay, so not directly starting with Babur, we'll right away start from Timur. Okay, Timur is the actually one question was asked in prelims also, like who is the lineage or who's the connection of Babur in the Central Asian region. Okay, and a lot of options will be given. So Timur is the person you need to know. Okay, so that story onwards we'll start. Also, UPSC is not going to ask you to write lengthy answers about this political thing, like brother will kill father, father will kill mother, or these kind of forming political kingdom is not usually asked. But if only if you know the story, you will be able to connect certain things, because chronology questions are asked repeatedly by UPSC. And also prelims related, a lot of factual thing will be there, like Babur introduced something in India, or Babur was the one who first defeated someone in a war, something like that. Battle related questions are asked in prelims. Okay, that is why these things are important. Okay, so let's begin. We'll start from the PDF itself, the actual PDF. Okay, so this it's a little bit lengthy. I think 20-30 pages are there. So I'll do it in two parts, where Timur and Babur and the formation of Mughal kingdom, that I'll discuss first in one video. And second video, I'll do the second part with I think second ruler, that is Humayun, and Sher Shah Suri is there. So those fighting part and battle part is there, which is again important. So 10 or 12 pages each, I'll cover it in two videos. Okay, so let's begin, else the video will be too much lengthy. So as you see the chapter name, Struggle for Empire in North India, Mughals and Afghan, 1525 to 1556. Okay, so this is the timeline mainly, but before even reaching to 1525, there are a lot of stories given here about the 1440s and all that timeline. So we'll see. Important changes took place in Central and West Asia during the 15th century. Okay, so after the disintegration of Mongol Empire in the 14th century, Timur united Iran and Turan. Okay, that is present day Iran and Afghanistan they are mentioning. Okay. So under one rule once again, so Timur actually united this thing after the disintegration of Mongol Empire. He was the one who actually united these two places. Then Timur's empire extended. Okay, you don't need to by heart all these things, but you should know all these are around Eastern Europe or Eurasian border and the Central Asian regions. Okay, lower Volga to the river Indus. Okay, Indus you know, and Volga is closer to the Eurasian border. So, and included Asia Minor, that is modern Turkey. Okay, you should know when these terms are referred to. Then Iran, Transoxiana, again the Central Asian region, and Afghanistan and part of Punjab. Okay, so from west of Punjab to till the Central Asian borders. Timur died in 1404. Okay, but his grandson Shahrukh Mirza 1448 was able to keep intact a large part of the empire. Okay, just like a story, just listen to. Okay, don't by heart anything. He gave patronage to art and arts and letters, and in his time Samarkand and Herat. Okay, again this time in prelims, if you remember, Mazar-e-Sharif, a place in western side of India, was asked. Okay, so it becomes important, these kind of places, and all UPSC will simply put one place in the left side and match it with the country name. Okay, so you should know Samarkand and Herat became the cultural centers of Western Asia. The ruler of Samarkand had great prestige in the entire Islam world. The power of the Timurids declined rapidly during the second half of the 15th century. largely due to the Timurid tradition of partitioning the empire. Okay, so they had this thing of they'll set up an empire, then partition and give governorship to different people. So that and all was reasons for their disintegration or the decline. You can tell the various Timurid principalities which arose from always fighting and wrangling among themselves. This provided an opportunity of two new elements to come to the forefront. From the north, a Mongol tribe, the Uzbeks. Okay, so that time there is no Uzbekistan as a country or something, but the Mongol tribe is actually Uzbeks. Okay, so those people from the north thrust into the Transoxiana. Okay, towards the little more south. Then the Uzbeks had become Muslims, but were looked down upon by the Timurids, who considered them to be uncultured barbarians. Okay, so that is how this Timurids considered them. Okay, these Uzbeks, the tribal people, as barbarians. Further to the west, a new dynasty, the Safavid dynasty, is very important, because later in Humayun story also you will learn, okay, Safavid, how it is important. It's actually near the Iran region. Okay, so they are telling about one the Uzbeks in the north and one the Safavid in the west. The Safavids descended from an order of saints who traced their ancestry to the Prophet. They supported the Shiite sect. You know, Shia and Sunni, even now in the Central Asia, Middle East and all, there are a lot of conflicts going on. So the Safavid dynasty was more of the Shia and the Uzbeks were more of the Sunni. Okay, that is what they are conveying here. And thus political conflict between the two elements were embittered by sectarian conflict. Further to the west of Iran, the power of the Ottoman Turks was rising. They wanted to dominate Eastern Europe as well as Iraq and Iran. So overall, again, they all want to establish power in the whole region. Thus, the scene was set for the conflict of three mighty empires in Asia during the 16th century. In 1494, at the age of 14, Babur succeeded to Fergana. Okay, even in Shashi Tharoor speech and all, you will hear this often. Okay, Fergana Valley, from there the Mughals came to India. So that term is often in the news. A small state in Transoxiana. Oblivious of the Uzbek danger, the Timurid princes were busy fighting one another. Babur too made a bid to conquer Samarkand from his uncle. Okay, so if you see, these are all relatives only. Someone's uncle will be there, someone's father will be there. So don't need to by heart all the things. Just know, like, there were conflicts within themselves. He won the city twice, but lost in no time on both the occasions. The second time, the Uzbek chief Shiabhani Khan was called in to help out. Okay, help out Babur. Okay, so again, these people are helping. I don't think very much important. Okay, I'm scrolling. So after this, they were like capturing, losing like that. The areas were going in and out of Babur's hand. Okay, we need to only see with respect to Babur. Rest, whatever names you see, it is not at all important and it has never been asked in the UPSC. Okay, so if you see here again, Herat is coming and his some other personality, it is going and coming, and historians call something like Khorasan region. Okay, that region. And a famous battle in 1510, Shah Ismail, the Shah of Iran, okay, defeated and killed Shiabhani Khan, that whatever name we saw there. Then Babur now made another attempt to recover Samarkand, this time with the help of Iranian forces. He was duly installed at Samarkand, but shaft under the control of Iranian generals, who wanted to treat Babur as the governor of an Iranian province rather than an independent prince. Okay, so these people who were there in Iran, the Iranian generals, they did not want Babur to rise as an independent prince. Okay, they were okay with Babur being a governor of a particular province. Okay, but they were not happy with Babur himself emerging as a prince. That is the whole crux of that whatever was written there. Meanwhile, the Uzbeks recovered rapidly from their defeat. Once again, Babur was ousted from Samarkand and had to return to Kabul. Finally, Shah Ismail himself was defeated in a famous battle by the Ottoman Sultan, thus leaving the Uzbeks masters of Transoxiana. These developments finally forced Babur to look towards India. So only if a question like this comes, like what were the incidents which led to the rise of Babur, or why Babur had to focus or shift his focus towards India, then all these things whatever we saw above is important. But I don't think it will be asked, because in GS1 anyway it is not asked. History optional students can pay a little more attention and read this textbook again, okay, because maybe they will need a political history of these kind of people. But GS1 you don't need it. Okay, they won't ask political history of any historical thing in ancient and medieval part. Okay, only from the 18th century it is important for GS1 and for prelims also these things won't be asked. So Babur says that from the time he obtained Kabul in 1504 to his victory at Panipat will come later, okay, 1526, I had never ceased to think of the conquest of Hindustan, but he had never found a suitable opportunity for undertaking it, hindered as I was sometimes by the oppression. It's not important, he's telling something or not. So like countless earlier invaders like Central Asia, Babur was drawn to India by the lure of the fabulous wealth. Okay, you know, Britishers also later comes because of the spices and all those things. So seeing India's wealth and gold and mines, riches, all these things only, these people, Babur also wanted to invade India. Okay, And also, he did not have any other options because other side he was going on losing the place, okay, Samarkand, Herat, and all. And Babur's ancestor Timur had not only carried away a vast treasure and many skillful artisans who helped him to consolidate his Asian empire and beautify his capital. Okay, so Timur long back had invaded India and taken back a lot of skilled workers also from here, and that is how they beautified their capital. And okay, and annexed some areas of Punjab. These areas remained in the possession of Timur's successor for several generations. When Babur conquered Afghanistan, he felt that he had a legitimate right to these areas. Okay, so Babur is now concentrating towards the east. Okay, Afghanistan, India, Pakistan, those regions. Another reason why Babur coveted the Punjab Paragonas was the meager income in Kabul. Okay, the historian Abul Fazl, later you will see in Akbar's time, remarks he ruled over Badakhshan, Kandahar, and Kabul, which did not yield sufficient income for the requirements of the army. In fact, in some of the border territories, the expense on controlling the army's administration was greater than the income. Okay, so if you see, income is less and the expenditure was more. Okay, so, with the meager income from Kabul, it was not possible. So Babur wanted more resources. That is why India is being invaded. Same story, only they are just going into more details. With these meager resources, Babur could not provide well for his Uzbeks and kinsmen. He was also apprehensive of an Uzbek attack. Okay, so he feared the Uzbek attack also on Kabul and considered India to be a good place of refuge and a suitable base for operations against Uzbek. Okay, because once you enter India, one good thing is like we have mountains in the Himalayas also, and the western side also we have that Hindu Kush and Sulaiman, Khitta ranges and all. Geography you would have learnt. So that advantage is there. So that is why Babur want to establish inside India. Okay, so that borders can be also protected and Uzbek threat also will not be there. The political situation in northwest India was suitable for Babur's entry into India. Sikandar Lodi had died in 1517. Okay, you know Lodi dynasty was there. Okay, Delhi Sultanate we learnt already in my MCQs also, it was covered in order. So we had the slave dynasty, then Khilji, then Tughlaq, then Sayyid dynasty, and then Lodi dynasty. That was the order. Okay, so in 1517, Sikandar Lodi will die and Ibrahim Lodi will succeed. Okay, Ibrahim Lodi was the last Lodi ruler whom Babur will defeat later. Okay, so Ibrahim's effort to create a large centralized empire had alarmed the Afghan chief as well as the Rajputs. And as the most powerful of the Afghan chief was Daulat Khan Lodi. Okay, so there was an Afghan chief there. Okay, not the Lodi ruler, but a chief, Daulat Khan Lodi, the governor of the Punjab, who was almost an independent ruler. So he attempted to throw away this person, Ibrahim Lodi. Okay, so a lot of things were attempted by himself, but later I think he will only invite Babur. Okay, see here, in 1518-19, Babur conquered the powerful fort of Bira. He then sent letters and verbal messages to Daulat Khan and Ibrahim Lodi asking for the cession of the areas which had belonged to the Turks, but Daulat Khan detained Babur's envoy at Lahore, neither granting him audience nor allowing him to go to Ibrahim Lodi. When Babur returned to Kabul, Daulat Khan expelled his agent from Bira. Okay, so they were without even entering India, Babur and this person had communication with each other. Okay, and they were like not allowing each other to capture places of each other. Okay, in 1520-21, Babur once again crossed the Indus and easily captured Bira and Sialkot. Okay, these are all forts there, the twin gateways to Hindustan. Okay, if you ask something like the twin gateway of Hindustan or something, Bira and Sialkot. Lahore also capitulated to him. He might have proceeded further, but for the news of the revolt at Kandahar, he retraced his steps and after a siege of a year and a half, recaptured Kandahar. Thus reassured, Babur was once again able to turn his attention towards India. Okay, again the Afghanistan-Pakistan region. Okay, he entered this place and then trying to get more and more region territorial access. It was about this time that Babur received an embassy from Daulat Khan Lodi, led by his son Dilawar Khan. Okay, so Daulat Khan Lodi and his son Dilawar Khan, they actually now will invite Babur to India. Okay, why? To displace Ibrahim Lodi. Okay, because he was a chief and he was a ruler. Okay, Daulat Khan is a chief and Ibrahim Lodi is a ruler. Since he was a tyrant and enjoyed no support from his nobles, it is probable that a messenger from Rana Sangha arrived at the same time inviting Babur to invade India. Okay, so if you see the Rajputs and the chief, okay, both were inviting Babur to come. Okay, one thing you should notice that there is no permanent friends or enemies, okay, in this medieval war battle time. Okay, these people will again fight with each other, okay, even though they are inviting and all. Later, Rana Sangha, Babur will again fight in a battle, which is discussed in this chapter, we'll see. Okay, so both were inviting Babur. These embassies convinced Babur that the time was ripe for the conquest of the whole of Punjab, if not of India itself. Okay, if not full India, at least the Punjab side you can conquer. So in 1525, while Babur was at Peshawar, he received the news that Daulat Khan Lodi had changed sides again. Okay, he had collected an army of about 30,000 men, ousted Babur's men from Sialkot and was marching on Lahore. At Babur's approach, the army of Daulat Khan melted away. Daulat Khan submitted and was pardoned. Thus, within 3 weeks of crossing the Indus, Babur became the master of the Punjab. Okay, so this is how he proceeded. Even though Daulat Khan switched sides. Okay, he only invited Babar, and he himself went and started taking places under Babar. So, but finally, what happened is Babar, seeing the strength of Babar, Daulat Khan finally submitted under him and was pardoned finally. Okay, it's not like killed or arrested or something. He's like coming under him, under Babar. Now, Babur will have the control of Punjab. Now it is the most important battle which is asked. There are three battles of Panipat we will learn in different chapters. So the first one is in 1526. Okay, don't need to remember this 20 April or not, but 1526 timeline at least you should know. Battle of Panipat. Okay, conflict with Ibrahim Lodi, the ruler of Delhi, was inevitable. And Babur prepared for it by marching towards Delhi. Ibrahim Lodi met Babur at Panipat. Okay, Panipat around Haryana region. Okay, that also main question has come, why the battles are happening at Panipat. Okay, or why the capital city of Mauryans, Guptas and all is at Pataliputra. So that's kind of location specific question is coming in GS1, so you should know. Okay, so with the force estimated at 1 lakh men and 1000 elephants, since the Indian armies generally contain large hordes of servants, the fighting men on Ibrahim Lodi's side must have been far less than this figure. Babur had crossed the Indus within a force of 12,000, but this had been swelled by the army in India. Nothing much important. Okay, they are coming with a lot of elephants and horses and all these things, and they are fighting with each other. Then I'll just go to details here. Okay, Babur had also secured the services of two Ottoman master gunners, Ustad Ali and Mustafa. Okay, the use of gunpowder had been gradually developing in India. Okay, this is a prelims question. It came 5 to 7 years back, I think. One statement, it was like Babur was the one who introduced gunpowder. But this will clearly tell you, like, Babur was not the one who introduced. It was already gradually developing in India. But Babur made use of it, okay, with the proper cannons and guns and all. Okay, but gunpowder was not introduced by Babur. Okay, UPSC can repeat questions, so please know this statement. Now Babur says that he is used it for the first time in his attack on the fortress of Bira. Okay, again that Bira Sial court is repeating. Apparently gunpowder was known in India, but its use became common in North India from the time of Babur. Okay, see, it's clearly given here. So UPSC has taken directly from Satish Chandra only. Okay, so that is why reading these textbooks becomes very, very important. Ibrahim Lodi had no idea of the strongly defended position of Babur. He had apparently expected Babur to fight a mobile mode of warfare, which was usual with the Central Asians, making rapid advances or retreating as the need arose. Then after 7-8 days, they are just telling day by day commentary kind of thing of these things. We don't need it. We'll see what happened at the end. Okay. Apparently, Ibrahim had little time to use them. So again, telling about even though they had elephants and all these things, he did not have much time to use it. Again, they are fighting these many people. We'll see what happens at the end. Okay. The Battle of Panipat is regarded as one of the decisive battles of Indian history. It broke the back of Lodi power and brought under Babur's control the entire area up to Delhi and Agra. Okay, so Battle of Panipat is why it is very much important, because the dynasty itself is changing from Lodi to Mughals. The treasures stored up by Ibrahim Lodi in Agra relieved Babur from his financial difficulties. The rich territory up to Jaunpur, again it's important, later Sher Shah Suri will come, also lay open to Babur. However, Babur had to wage two hard-fought battles, one against Rana Sangha of Mewar. See, this person only invited Babur, and now they both are going to fight with each other. And the other against the Eastern Afghans. Okay, before he could consolidate his hold on his area. So after Panipat, two more battles are there, important battles. Viewed from this angle, the Battle of Panipat was not as decisive as the political field has been made out. So it's telling, even though Panipat is remembered in history and all, these battles are also important. Its real importance lies in the fact that it opened a new phase in the struggle for domination in North India. The difficulties of Babur after his victory at Panipat were manifold. Okay, so many other challenges were also there. Many of his Begs were not prepared for a long campaign in India. Okay, with the onset of the hot weather, the misgiving had. So telling about the army, okay, this hot Indian climate and all those things, and these people were not ready for a long campaign like this, like war after war. If you remember Mauryan's time, or before that time, when Alexander was coming to India, that time also this was the problem. Alexander was having war after war. Okay, so by the time it crossed the Indus River and tried to enter India and all, the entire army was already tired and was not able to proceed. And also in India there was this Nanda dynasty. I think Dhanananda was the ruler with 6,000 elephants and a lot of things, which we learnt in previous chapters. Okay, in ancient history I had taught you all these things. So that similar situation is there for Babur also. Okay, the army is not ready for a continuous campaign like this. Then obviously the memories of Timur sacking. So this is actually a remarkable hostility. This term, if you see, the people did not receive Babur in a proper way. Okay, they were not happy with it, because Timur had actually invaded and plundered all the towns long back. Okay, so that memories were still there in the minds of the people. That's what they're telling. Babur was not well received by Indians. Babur knew that the resources in India alone would enable him to found a strong empire and satisfy his begs. Not for us, One second, not for us. The poverty of Kabul again. Okay, so he's again looking for the riches in India. Okay, not just have a political power, but economic power also. He thus took a firm stand, proclaiming his intention to stay on in India and granting leave to a number of his Uzbeks who wanted to go back to Kabul. Okay, so he was managing the people. Okay, who was tired and who want to go back and all can go back. This immediately cleared the air, but it also invited the hostility of Rana Sangha, who began his preparation for a shutdown with Babur. Okay, so that is Battle of Khandwa. This also is a UPSC question. Battle of Khandwa is fought between between who and who? Okay, in our MCQs also all these are extensively covered. The growing conflict between Rana Sangha and Ibrahim Lodi for the domination of eastern Rajasthan and Malwa has already been mentioned. After defeating Mahmud Khalji of Malwa, the influence of the Rana had gradually extended up to Pilyakhar, a small river in the neighborhood of Agra. Okay, this is one river, Pilyakhar, near Agra. Okay, so he was expanding from the western side. He is growing closer towards Delhi or Agra. Okay, this person, Rana Sangha. The establishment of empire in Indo-Gangetic Valley by Babur was a threat to Rana Sangha. Sangha set preparation effort to expel Babur, or at any rate to confine him to the Punjab. Okay, so that is what Rana Sangha wanted. Just be in the Punjab region where actually he invited, come and take over. But other places, Sangha was not happy. Rana Sangha was not happy. Babur accuses Rana Sangha of breach of agreement. He says that Sangha had invited him to India and promised to join him against Ibrahim Lodi, but made no move while he conquered Delhi and Agra. So even though he invited, he did not help him. Okay, Rana Sangha did not help Babur to take over Delhi. We do not know what precise agreement Sangha has made. He might have hoped for a long drawn out warfare during which he would have been able to seize the areas he coveted, or he might have been hoped like Timur Babur would withdraw after sacking Delhi. Okay, so that is what Rana Sangha thought. He will come, invade some places and go away. Rana Sangha did not expect Babur to settle down. Okay, you know, next many years, okay, 300, 400 years, Mughals will be here. So that actually was not expected by Rana Sangha. Babur's decision to stay on India completely changed the situation. Many Afghans, including Mahmud Lodi, a younger brother of Ibrahim Lodi, rallied to Rana Sangha in the hope of regaining the throne of Delhi. Okay, so now these people are again, like, it's all very complicated kind of thing. Okay, Rana Sangha will call Babur to defeat Ibrahim Lodi. Now, Ibrahim Lodi's brother is going back to Rana Sangha and telling, okay, now we'll throw Babur out. Okay, so they are all, whatever situation demands, they will again change sides like this. So not at all important. That's what is my final message for UPSC. They don't play with these kind of things, but as per the last 2 years of prelims, if you see, we can't say that also as a guarantee, because UPSC is kind of going to any extreme to make 10 or 15 questions like much unsolvable kind of question. Okay. The reputation of Rana Sangha and his early success against some of the outlying Mughal posts such as Bayana demoralized Babur soldiers. To rally them, Babur solemnly declared the war against Sangha to be a jihad. Okay, so just Babur again declaring war and all. On the eve of the battle, he emptied all the wine jars and broke the wine flask to demonstrate what a staunch Muslim he was. He also banned the sale and purchase of wine throughout his dominions and abolished custom taxes on the Muslims. Okay, so these are some statements. If UPSC wants to trouble you, they can take it up. Okay, like he was a staunch Muslim, he was against this wine and liquor and all these things, then he abolished the custom tax on the Muslims. So it was a kind of pro-Muslims and a true hardcore Muslim kind of thing. Okay, that is what is conveyed here, Babur. Babri Masjid issues are still going on. So these things become important. Okay, anything related to Babur will be important. Having carefully selected a site, Babur entrenched himself at Khandwa, over 40 km from Agra. Okay, so that is where Battle of Khandwa will happen. As at Panipat, he lashed together a number of wagons as an outer bastion and dug a trench in front for double protection. Gaps were left in the defences for his musketeers to fire and advance behind wheeled tripods. Okay, so these are all like very much detailing. Okay, very much detailing into the method of war and what and all he did. Okay, the Battle of Khandwa, 1527. Okay, just 1 year after Battle of Panipat, was fiercely contested. According to Babur, Sangha's forces exceed 2 lakh, including 10,000 Afghan cavalrymen and an equal force wielded by Hasan Khan Mewati. Okay, so this is an Afghan side. Okay, as usual, these figures may be greatly exaggerated. Okay, that's also one thing you should know. Many textbooks, many Chinese travelers and all, they have told so much great things about India. Even the Greek writers, okay, Meander, these people and all, they have written lot of big things that it's hard to believe. Okay, about Vijayanagara dynasty, about Maurya dynasty and all. But anyway, historians have no other go. They have to go with whatever is written in these textbooks. So, however, the Mughal artillery took a heavy toll of life and slowly Sangha's forces were pushed back. At this juncture, Babur ordered his soldiers in the center, who had been sheltering behind their tripods, to launch an attack. The artillery also advanced behind the chained wagons. Sangha's forces were thus hemmed in and were defeated after a great slaughter. So finally, the climax is this thing only. Okay, Babur again won one more battle. Rana Sanga escaped and wanted to renew the conflict with Babur, but he was poisoned by his own nobles, who considered such a course to be dangerous and suicidal. Okay, so this is also one statement. If you want, you can remember like who was the one who was poisoned by his own nobles. It was Rana Sanga. Okay, so like that he was killed. Thus died one of the most valiant warriors produced by Rajasthan. With Sanga's death, the dream of a united Rajasthan extending up to Agra received a serious setback. The Battle of Khandwa secured Babur's position in the Delhi-Agra region. Babur strengthened his position further by conquering the chain of forts. So Gwalior, Dholpur, etc. All these are forts, okay, east of Agra. He also annexed last parts of Alwar from Hasan Khan Mewati. Okay, Hasan Khan Mewati we saw earlier also. Okay. So he then led a campaign against Medini Rai of Chanderi in Malwa. Chanderi was captured after the Rajput defenders had died fighting for the last man and Jauhar. Okay, Jauhar, you know, Padmavati movie also you would have seen, their climax is this thing, Jauhar. Okay. So that happens, okay, that time whenever this Rajput is involved, this thing will be happening, okay, Rajput versus Muslim rulers. So Babur had to cut short his plan of further campaigns in the area on hearing of the growing activities of Afghans in eastern Uttar Pradesh, okay. So this way, they are just showing the showing how powerful a leader Babur was, okay. He was emerging as one of the strongest rulers and he was capturing place after places and defeating most important rulers which was ruling in India, okay, in the Rajasthan side and also in the Delhi side. Afghans. Although the Afghans had been defeated, they had not been reconciled to the Mughal rule. Eastern Uttar Pradesh was still under the domination of Afghan chiefs who had tendered their allegiance to Babur but were prepared to throw it off at any time. Okay, so as I told, there is no permanent friends or enemies in war. The Afghan Sardars were being backed by Nusrat Shah, the ruler of Bengal. Okay, now eastern side is also coming, who had married a daughter of Ibrahim Lodi. So if you see these marriage alliances happening, not only in the Hindu side or the Mauryan side and all, it's happening in the Lodi dynasty also. Okay, so someone, Ibrahim Lodi's daughter was married to the ruler of this this place, Bengal, okay, Nusrat Shah. So again, one challenge from that side. A number of times, the Afghans had ousted the Mughal officials in eastern Uttar Pradesh and reached up to Kannauj. Kannauj will repeatedly come, okay. History optional students, please try to know the exact location where Kannauj is on the Indian map because you have a map-based question. But their greatest weakness was the lack of a popular leader. After some time, Mahmud Lodi, a brother of Ibrahim Lodi, who had fought against Babur at Khandwa, reached Bihar at the invitation of the Afghan leaders. Okay, so now everyone are plotting against one single leader, okay, because Babur is the most powerful one now. The Afghans hailed him as the ruler and mustered strength under him. This was a threat which Babur could not ignore. Hence, at the beginning of 1529, he left Agra for the east. Crossing the Ganga near Banaras, he faced the combined force of Afghans and Nusrat Shah of Bengal at the crossing of river Ghagra. Okay, all these locations you should know because geography, anyway we are learning all the rivers. One second. Okay, where did we stop? Okay, the Afghans hailed him as the ruler and mustered strength under him. Hence, it was beginning of 1529, he left Agra for the east, crossing the Ganga near Banaras. Okay, till here we did. Although Babur crossed the river and compelled the Bengal and the Afghan armies to retreat, he could not win a decisive victory. Then Babur decided to patch up an agreement with the Afghans. He put forward a vague claim for suzerainty over Bihar, but left most of it in the hands of the Afghan chiefs. He then returned to Agra. Shortly afterwards, while on his way to Kabul, Babur died near Lahore. Okay, so this is Babur was successful in the west, successful in Delhi, Agra, successful in defeating Rana Sanga and Ibrahim Lodi. But when the eastern side, that the Bengal ruler and Mahmud Lodi and Afghan chiefs, many people tried to plot against them together, he did not have a decisive victory. And also the Bihar areas, eastern areas and all were left under the hands of Afghan chiefs. And while returning, he, like I think he died. Okay, that is the whole story of Babur. So it was a very short span. If you see other Mughal rulers later, you will see like 30 years, 40 years and all they ruled. But this is like 1526 he started. And I think by 1530 he will die. Okay, time is not given here, but I remember it's 1530. Okay, so we will see. Okay, significance. Now, from this UPSC, I have picked up a lot of statements. I think gunpowder related statement also will repeat again. Okay, significance of Babur's advent into India. This can be a mains question. Okay, so pay attention. Babur's advent into India was significant from many point of view. For the first time since the downfall of the Kushan Empire, Kabul and Kandahar became integral parts of an empire comprising North India. You know the Kushan Empire, Kanishka and all, he had this western side also under the empire, okay, including the China route, okay, trade route. So after that, this is the first time someone is integrating all these places together, and that is Babur. And Babur and his successors were able to give to India security from external invasion for almost 200 years. So it's telling about the whole Mughal Empire, which we'll study in the next chapters. So economically also, the control of Kabul and Kandahar strengthened India's foreign trade, since these two towns were the starting point for caravans meant for China and Mediterranean seaports. Okay, so it's a kind of a connecting point for trade in either direction. That is why this integration is important. Thus, India could take a greater share in the great trans-Asian trade. Okay. These kind of terms, if you use in your answers, it's always good. Okay, great share in the great trans-Asian trade. In North India, Babur smashed the power of the Lodis and of the Rajput Confederacy led by Rana Sanga. Thereby, he destroyed the balance of power obtaining in the area. This was a long step towards the establishment of an All India Empire. However, a number of conditions had still to be fulfilled before this could be achieved. Babur showed what a skilled combination of artillery and cavalry could achieve. His victories led to rapid popularization of gunpowder and artillery in India, thereby reducing the importance of forts. Okay, you know, before that, forts, guerrilla warfare, these were all very, very important. Later also, it will come again, okay, in the Maratha rule and all. But this was replaced because, or it was reducing because gunpowder and artillery was efficiently used. Okay, right from the time of Babur, it is efficiently used. Babur introduced a new mode of warfare in India. Although gunpowder was known in India before, by his new military methods as well as by his personal conduct, Babur re-established the prestige of the crown, which had been eroded since the death of Firoz Tughlaq. Okay, so Firoz Shah Tughlaq is like 2-3 dynasties before Mughal. Okay, so that time what was there, that level of warfare methods were introduced or popularized by Babur. Again, see the statement, gunpowder was known in India before. Okay, so this one statement UPSC put as a statement, and that year students were finding it very, very difficult. Now, because you are doing previous year questions and all, you will be thinking like it's a very normal statement. But suddenly, when all of a sudden UPSC takes such statements from random textbooks, it becomes very difficult. Okay, so that is why pay attention to each and every word and start practicing statement type MCQs right from now. Okay, that is why we also opened the test series very early, because you will need repeated 2-3 readings of these kind of things. Okay, so if you learn through MCQs, it's better. You will know that elimination skills, and you will know, okay, this statement I have seen, it is false, it is true. So that level you will reach. So try to focus now itself for prelims and mains both. So, although Sikandar Lodi and Ibrahim Lodi had tried to re-establish the prestige of the crown, Afghan ideas of tribal independence and equality had resulted in only a partial success. Babur had the prestige of being a descendant of two of the most famous warriors of Asia. Okay, this also was a UPSC statement. Okay, like his mother's lineage is somewhere, father's lineage is somewhere. So, this Chinggis Khan and Timur, okay, both you should know. Both are his lineage only. None of the nobles could therefore claim a status of equality with him or aspire to his throne. The challenge to his position, if any, could come only from a Timurid prince. Babur endeared himself to his becks by his personal qualities. He was always prepared to share the hardship with his soldiers. Once at the height of winter, Babur was returning to Kabul. The snow was so deep that horses would sink into it, and parties of soldiers had to trample the snow so that the horses could pass. Without hesitation, Babur joined into the backbreaking task. So he's it's just telling like he was very much close with his these soldiers also, and he will involve equally like the soldiers. It's not like he will be sitting on a horse or chariot and something and just doing the commanding work. He will be equally participating in the warfare and the hardship whatever they faced equally with all the soldiers. Okay, at every step the snow came up to the waist or the chest. He says after a few steps the man in front could be exhausted and another would take his place. When 10, 15 or 20 persons had trampled the snow thoroughly, then alone a horse could pass over it. So just telling the hardship which they faced. Okay, and Babur was participating in it. Babur was fond of wine and good company and was a good and merry companion at the same time. It's kind of biography, okay, not very important. He was a stern, a disciplinarian and a hard taskmaster. He took good care of his becks and was prepared to excuse many of their faults as long as they were not disloyal. Okay, so if the persons were disloyal, he would punish them, else like he would always pardon them if it's something minor. He was prepared to adopt the same attitude towards Afghan and Indian nobles. However, he did have a streak of cruelty, probably inherited from his ancestors, for he made towers of skulls from the heads of the opponents of number of. Okay, so that cruelty is also there in his blood. That's what he is telling. Okay, the historian is trying to tell. Like with his men, he was like okay and good and like very close and all. But he had this activity of building towers of skulls of the head of people. Okay, whom he killed in the war. Then, though an Orthodox Sunni, okay, so they are Sunni Muslims, was not begotten or led by the religious divines at a time when there was a bitter sectarian feud between the Shias and Sunnis in Iran and Duran, his court was free from theological and sectarian conflicts. Okay, so even though he is a Sunni follower, Orthodox Sunni follower, his court did not have this problem, okay, like any discrimination against Shia or something. There was no conflict among Shias and Sunnis. later you will see Akbar also like is a like more secular ruler, okay, at that time. Though he declared the battle against Sangha, Ejjihad had assumed the title of Ghazi over the victory, and reasons were clearly political. Okay, so it's like it's not because Rana Sangha is a Hindu or it's like Rajput or something. It's purely political. That's what is the message conveyed here. Though it was a period of war, only a few instances can be found of destruction of temple. Okay, so if you see, there is nothing like destroy temple, then build them mosque and all those things. Okay, Babur is not mentioned anywhere here in this textbook like as a very orthodox Sunni or something. He is okay with all kind of religions. Babur was deeply learned in Persian and Arabic and is regarded as one of the two most famous writers in the Turkish language, which was his mother tongue. Okay, as a this also is important. Okay, UPSC will take a statement and simply put like Persian language instead of Turkish, they'll put Persian, so you should know. As a prose writer, he had no equal, and his famous memoirs, the Tuzuk-i-Babri, is considered one of the classics of world literature. Okay, Tuzuk-i-Babri, Turkish language. Okay, his other works include Masnavi and the Turkish translation of a well-known Sufi work. He was in touch with the famous poets and artists of the time and described their works in the memoirs. He has been a keen naturalist and has described the flora and fauna of India in considerable detail. Thus, Babur introduced a new concept of the state, which was to be based on the strength and prestige of the crown, absence of religious and sectarian bigotry, and the careful fostering of culture and the fine arts. He thus provided a precedent and a direction for his successors. Okay, we'll continue the rest in the next video only, because next we have to do Humayun and Sher Shah Suri. But overall, try to understand this personality related history, what is given, like warfare, how strong he was, how he was with his people, how he was with the opponents, then his writing skills, then this Turkish language, this book name. So these kind of pointers, if you know, right, then UPSC cannot trick you with anything else. Okay, these are the maximum 10 or 15 points about every person. So it's like one reading, maybe you got it, but when the statements comes in a little bit twisted work, like he was only person who translated some book, or he was only person who did a Sufi work, that is where you need your effective knowledge. Like you have to read this also, you have to read Humayun also, you have to read everything. So it will come with time. Okay, so don't worry when you see questions. Don't even, and also one more thing I want, don't wait for all your portions to get completed. That will never happen. Okay, there are many students I know who will tell like, I want to complete the syllabus first and then only I will practice MCQs. That is a very wrong method of studying for a UPSC at least. Okay, for other exams it's okay. For UPSC you have to learn through MCQs. Okay, because MCQ, even in the last minute, even in the exam, when you enter the exam hall, even before that, maybe last line which you read will be the first time you are reading that line. Okay, and that exactly will come in the exam also. So this exam is never going to reach a stage where you will finish your preparation. You will never finish your preparation. Okay, because it has no syllabus. Okay, everything in the world you have to learn. So please have these factual things by heart in your mind right from now. Okay, so I'll make another video. We'll continue from exactly this point. Okay, Humayun's conquest. So I think I'll show two MCQs related to what we did, or at least the Babur related age. Okay, because there are a lot of questions which we can make from this story alone, Babur story. So this actually is not mentioned in this thing, but it's part of our medieval history set. So try to answer it in comment section. Okay, because I want you people to do some research also. Simply if you read one textbook and go, it is not enough for this exam. Okay, so Charbagh was introduced in India by Babur. Okay, it's not there in this chapter. Okay, and Sikandar Lodi's tomb was the first garden tomb built in India. Okay, so this is actually one controversial statement also. I'll tell you why. If someone answers, I'll tell you the correct explanation for this. But if not, it's going to remain like this only. Okay, only if you get by the test series you will get it, because simply me giving lecture and then again giving test series with the question and answer, then I don't feel like that's the right way. Okay, students has to interact. So try to answer this, like whether both, if it's asking for true statement, so if both are true or anything is false or something. One more question we'll see. Which of the following battles saw the victory of a Mughal ruler? Okay, so UPSC has twisted it overall. They didn't ask a particular battle or something. They asked you about their holistic knowledge. Okay, like saw the victory of a Mughal ruler. That means not even participate. They have to win also. So which are the battles? First battle of Panipat 1526, battle of Khanwa 1527, Ghagra battle 1529, battle of Chausa 1539. I know that only the first two is covered in this chapter. But if you have the knowledge of this, then try to answer this. Also, your options is designed in such a way that if you see 1 and 2 is there everywhere, because we have already done this also. Okay, 1, 2, we know Babur won the thing, so it is a victory of a Mughal ruler. 3 and 4, try to find out, or anyway in my next lecture it will be covered. But before that, if you know, that is well and good. Okay, that is how you should learn. So I'll come up with the next video soon. So till then, enjoy your learning. Thank you and have a nice day.